Oh, the music was out of sight. Well, you take the musicians, they would come from other cities to come to Kansas City.
This is the home of modern jazz. You know, they say Kansas City jazz, but actually it's the home of modern jazz because of Charlie Parker, who is the cap of the cap. You know, he was the man that changed the whole music scene.
If you go anywhere, like any building that plays jazz, they always talk about, oh, you go to Kansas City, oh, go down to 18th and Vine, that's where jazz was established.
The jazz era in Kansas City had its origins around 1920. New Orleans did a crackdown on the jazz clubs in the period around World War I, so there was kind of a dispersal of a lot of those musicians. At the same time in Memphis, you had a lot of blues musicians beginning to come to the fore, and several of those folks gravitated then toward Kansas City.
Let's credit all the greats, Charlie Parker, Duke Ellington, you know, all the wonderful Sonny Rollins, you know, all these wonderful musicians that have been through the Kansas City area at some time or another. A lot of them even lived here and were raised up in this area.
The jazz clubs, as they developed, were certainly places that you could go hear good music, but they were also places that you could get a drink, which in the 1920s was technically illegal. Prohibition, it was quite easy to get a drink here, thanks to Pendergast influence.
It was during the time that Pendergast was primarily running the city that jazz developed. Tom Pendergast is either loved him or you hated him. There was no gray area with that man.
The origins of the Pendergast machine go back to the 1890s, when the older of the two brothers, Jim Pendergast, was elected to the city council. They built then a strong political base in the city council through the years of Jim Pendergast. He died in 1911. Tom took his place for a few years. After 1915, Tom Pendergast never held elective office again in Kansas City, but he was able, sometimes more than others, to make sure that his friends did.
He would hold court in the second floor of his office at 1908 Main Street, and the lines would snake down the stairs and out into the street as they came in to ask favors of him, money, food, clothing, shelter, but of course it always was for a vote.
Pendergast realized that if he had a majority on the council, then he could name his own city manager, which he did. From that point until, you might say, the fall of Pendergast, which was in 1939, Pendergast was in complete control of the city government. By 1937, Pendergast was either controlling or closely connected with something like 20 operating companies in Kansas City, most of which had contracts either with the city or county government. The county courthouse in downtown Kansas City, for that matter, the county courthouse on the square in Independence, the city hall, municipal auditorium, the whole civic center area downtown, for the most part, is a legacy of the Pendergast era from the 1930s.
There's no doubt that Tom's reign in Kansas City was anything but an honest one. And I've talked with people who have told me that their families would not have survived had it not been for Tom Pendergast.